picture that is going to talk to us a little bit about the ministry of our Lord Jesus Christ. And that is such a beautiful picture because we know that his ministry did not stop after his death, burial, and his resurrection, but that he is ministering for us in the sanctuary. Amen?
Amen.
Now, I want you to know that saying amen to the preacher is like saying sick 'em to the dog. So if you would like to have a happy sermon, let's talk back. It's not all about me today. It's about us receiving the Word of God. There was a pastor who was new to a community, and he preached his sermon. And then the next week he came back, and he preached the same sermon. And the next week he came back and he preached the same sermon. And the people in the congregation, finally a little lady came up to him at the door and she says, "You know, Pastor, you have preached the same sermon three times in a row." And he said, "Well, I figure when the congregation starts doing what I'm asking them to do in the sermon, I'll change the sermon." Well, for your benefit, I know that some of you will have heard many of the things that we're going to be presenting today. But it took me a while to wrap my head around it. So I'm assuming that some other people might need repetition. In French, our word for practice, if you're going to practice a song, on fait la répétition. You make a repetition. So repetition is good for learning. If you've already heard this, well, I always used to say when I listened to an evangelistic series over 8 years, until I was able to give the presentation, I guess I could hear it again. So that's what I'll throw out to you. Little disclaimer. And now if you would be so kind, I'd like to pray for myself. Heavenly Father, I need your help so much, and I've already given my heart to you and asked you to take control in the beautiful prayer that Diana prayed. That's what we are asking for, Father, for your moving, a moving of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. In this three stages, there's planning stage and eternity past. We're going to talk about salvation. We're going to talk about what it means to you. There's a lot of Seventh-day Adventists, and I've met a few of them, that really just have a problem with any kind of sense of assurance. We've been told that that we can't say we're saved because it's not over yet. But there's so much more to assurance. There's so much more to believing God's word that puts us in a place where we can have the joy of the Lord, which is our strength. So we're going to talk about some parts of salvation and the way God has laid it out. There was a planning stage in eternity past, and there was also the second part there that says, the reality stage through Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. And then there's the experience stage, receiving the gift. So with these three stages, as we look at it, folks, it is moving and we're all good. There is throughout your New Testament, there's a key phrase, and it's called in Christ. This theme recurs over and over, and it's sometimes expressed by other phrases, such as through Christ, by Christ, and those kinds of things. But this concept of being in Christ is one we're going to talk about a little bit today. In Christ's motif in Romans 6, I want to just bring this out also. Who is a believer? Who is a believer? If you're in Christ, are you a believer? Amen or no?
Amen.
Amen. So who is a believer? Let's talk about that. Satan and his angels tremble and believe, but they're still wicked, right?
Right.
So knowing about Christ and knowing Christ, is there a difference? There is a difference. And is there a miracle in the new birth? These are some things that we want to talk about. Is there a miracle in the new birth? Now, in James 2, verse 19, that's the one where you believe there is one God, you do well, even the demons believe and tremble. So here's the question. How would I know if you believe something? Well, if I told you that the building's on fire and everyone should evacuate, how would I know that you believed what I said? Because the building is not on fire. However, if I told you that, how would I know that you believed me? People would be standing up, quietly walking to the sides, and they'd be exiting out the door, right? So how do I know if you don't believe me? You'd just be sitting like a lump of bump on a pickle, as we used to say. So here we are. We can quite definitely definitely say that believing is going to result, or there will be a ramification of believing, and it is what? Action, movement, something's going to happen. Something will be different. In Christ, in the Christ motif in Romans 5, this is one of our favorite thoughts, because this is so beautiful. For if by one man's offense, death reigned through the one, much more those who receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness will reign in life through the one, Jesus Christ. You notice it's the end of a parenthetical paragraph that Paul would do. I always think about the fact that he did not have any kind of, remember when the computers came out that we could do select, and we could backspace and it would take it away, just like it was never there. And then we got word processors. Well, Paul, once it was going down in ink on that parchment, it was pretty much, oh, you better keep going. Not like he didn't know where he was going, but his parenthetical phrases are really big and they're important. And this is the end of a parenthetical paragraph. That one of the most important paragraphs that we could ever read is right there. And we talked about it in Sabbath school, so we're going to go on a little bit. Therefore, as through one man's offense, judgment came to all men. Who was the one man? Resulting in what? Even so, through one man's righteous act, the free gift came to how many men?
All men.
Marty talked about all. That is quite a big word, isn't it? Resulting in justification of life, for as by one man's disobedience, many were made sinners, so also by one man's obedience, many will be made righteous. And who was the one man who did the righteous acts?
Jesus Christ.
That's right. Here's Romans 5, 20, 21. Again, even so, grace might reign through righteousness to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Again, this is the part where what Jesus has done is what gets us our righteousness. Now, this is no news to those of us who have been studying. We know this. But how beautiful it comes out in 1 Corinthians 15, 22. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. Isn't it amazing to think that there's a little baby somewhere that's not yet been born that already shares in Adam's sinful nature? That's crazy, isn't it? Never done anything yet. Never done anything wrong. How many of you have ever compared the first Adam to the second Adam? Compared first Adam, real Adam, to the second Adam, Christ. Let's do it. This is not a great slide, but let's try it. And these verses are right from where we just were. Transgression entered, but by Christ grace entered. By the first Adam, condemnation resulted. By the second Adam, justification resulted. By the first Adam, death reigned. By the second Adam, life reigns. By the first Adam, condemnation to all. By the second Adam, justification to all. By the first Adam, declared sinners. By the second Adam, were declared righteous. By the first Adam, sin abounded, and by the second Adam, grace abounded. By the first Adam, sin reigned to death, and by the second Adam, grace reigns to life eternal. So even that little baby who's not yet born is a partaker of this second Adam's redemption. Is that true or false?
True. Yes.
True. So now, here we are. I'm not going to change this for a second, because one of the questions that comes up to me, and it's out of Romans 1, where it says that the law was written in the heart of the heathen people, and how even some people that have never known the name of Jesus, that they're going to be able to be part of heaven. And they're going to get to be partakers of this wonderful heritage of eternal life that we're going to receive. How is that possible? How is that possible? Well, we're going to take a look at some other theological premises, and I don't think that they're correct. I think they're incorrect. But three of them are coming up right here, right now. I happen to know somebody who decided that they wanted to walk in the homosexual lifestyle. And they just told me, well, I think our God is much bigger and much more kind than you think your God is. And so he adopted universalism. And universalism is one of the religious ideas about God, and we'll talk about it in a second. Then Calvinism, based on John Calvin, one of the reformers, and Wesleyan and Arminianism, and that was, there was a guy, Arminian guy, I forget his whole name. Can I tell me?
Jacob.
Say his last name again.
Arminius.
Thank you for giving me that. And he had a concept that is pretty much in the Wesleyan tradition. And then there's Bible truth about what really happened that we can get out of our Bible. Amen? So as we go on here, if we talk about universalism, which is what that friend of mine said, it's just that all sinful and alienated souls will ultimately be reconciled to God, and there's divine love and mercy. And believe it or not, even in Mormonism, there's a fashion of universalism. I don't know if you ever studied with those folks, but they've got four levels of hell, and you get to graduate out of all of them until finally you can be a god as well. So there's a universalism, and is this ring true with you? No, we love the part that they want to exalt God's divine love and mercy, but we know that that's not what the Bible teaches. So universalism is not correct. In Christ motif, we talk about Calvinism, what John Calvin taught. Now, very frequently you find this in your Baptist friends, and the extreme of it, where it doesn't come out right, is that you can just keep on sinning, and God's got to take you to heaven anyway, because once he did, once you said those magic words, he's got to take you. And that's the way it goes. And that's an extreme version. Of course, what we're looking at here is that only the elect can go, and it's a limited atonement. In other words, what Jesus did on the cross was not for everyone. It was just for certain ones that God has already predestined to be saved. Well, the limits of that are shown like when the Dutch reformers went down to, South Africa. And they met with people of a different color, of a different people group, because we are all one race, one blood, the Bible says. But when they met with those people, would you believe that they were not even sure? No, I said it was the Dutch reformers. I'm not sure now. Anyway, the missionaries that went there that held to Calvinism were not sure that they should even preach the gospel to anybody down in that country, because they were not even sure that what Jesus had done on the cross was applicable to these people of a different color. Can you believe that? Well, that was a backward thing, and it was based on their religion of believing that there was only certain people that Jesus died for. It was a limited atonement. Then we move on to the Wesleyan Arminianism, and this part is only believes that only after repentance and belief does God place one in Christ. Now, who's doing the repenting? Yes. Who's doing the believing? Man. And so then God does something and puts somebody in Christ. So the problem with this is it's a potentially just a provisional atonement. This means that the only people that have received or can receive salvation are people who take the initiative, and they're the ones who do something toward God. If that's what the Bible says, then how can it be that Adam was the first Adam and Christ was the second Adam, and all this was accomplished when Christ went to the cross? You see, these are the things that are troubling to us, and most of us have been affected by some of these other religions, and I'll put it out there, these other doctrines. You may not know it, but if you turn on the radio, or if you listen to somebody else's sermon, or you casually come from another denomination, or you're a raised Adventist and you say, well, we're Arminian. I've heard people say that. They just say, we're Arminian. And then you say, okay, we're Arminian, without going back to the scriptures and seeing what the scripture actually teaches. So as we look at this, we're going to take a little quick thing. And why? Why? Because what you believe about what Jesus did affects how you feel about how you feel, how you think, how you act in your daily life. If this wasn't part applicable to what to how you're going to live for God, then we wouldn't even worry about it. But there's people that are disturbed about their salvation, and they are alienated from God, when God was in Christ doing what? What's the big word? Reconciling the world unto himself. Amen? All right, well, now let's look at this really quickly. We have free will or human ability. Over in Calvinism, it's playing out that there's total depravity and total inability. Parts of these you're going to agree with on either side. You're going to be surprised to see some of the things you understand from the Bible on both sides. But like the end part is, now, this part in Arminianism, that anybody could be saved, is still there, but it's the could, the conditional part. This part is particular redemption or limited atonement in Calvinism. The Holy Spirit can be effectually resisted, but in Calvinism, the efficacious call of the Spirit or irresistible grace is what they believe in. Once you've been born again, there's no way that you ever turn God down. And then Arminianism, Methodist, basically, believe in the Nazarene, Church of Nazarene, that you can fall from grace. And the Calvinism teaches the perseverance of the saints. It's funny how all these things are a little bit mixed up. There's a little bit of reality in the experiential part of our salvation that they're dealing with. But according to Calvinism, salvation is accomplished by the Almighty Triune God. From almighty power of the Triune God, the Father chose a people, the Son died for them, the Holy Spirit makes Christ's death effective by help, by bringing the elect to faith and repentance, thereby causing them to willingly obey the gospel. There it is, there's a definition. And according to Calvinism, the entire process, election, redemption, regeneration, is the work of God and is by grace alone. Thus, God, not man, determines who will be the recipients of the gift of salvation. Well, part of that sentence is true. God has determined. He is the chief mover in our salvation. But, again, this would be provisional, that not everybody can be saved. So Arminianism, they countered against this, and they said, no, what Jesus did is for anybody can be saved. So for them, its salvation is accomplished through the combined efforts of God, who takes the initiative, and man, who must respond. Man's response being the determining factor, God has provided salvation for everyone, but his provision becomes effective only for those who, of their own free will, choose to cooperate with him and accept his offer of grace. You know, a whole lot of this is dealing with the experience that each of us, almost everybody has experienced. So that's why it seems almost true. But it's neglecting what was done for us before the foundations of the world. We'll go ahead to that in a moment. At the crucial point, man's will plays a decisive role. Thus, man, not God, determines who will be the recipients of the gift of salvation. That is so poignant, so poignant. And that's why some people get so depressed, because they think it depends on me. And since it depends on me and I can't do it, I won't be saved. Today we talked in Sabbath school about going for a walk with a toddler. If you're going for a walk with a little toddler that's just barely learning to walk, can barely walk by themselves, and you say to the toddler, hold my hand, who is actually has the responsibility for the toddler to fall? Toddler reaches up, takes hand, hits a little crack in the sidewalk, and stumbles. Who's holding whose hand? Just a question. Just a thought. For when the Gentiles who do not have the law, we're going to get back to this part about how can it be that some people can be saved. If I was a Calvinist, and God has only picked out certain people to be saved, and they don't know, they're in the jungle and they don't know God. How can that take place? If I'm an Arminian and it all depends upon people's decision to do this, how can that take place? So there's something here that God said, when the Gentiles who do not have the law by nature do the things in the law, these, although not having the law, are a law to themselves, who show the work of the law written in their hearts. If it's written in their hearts, then they're beginning to do it, right? Their conscience bear the witness. You know this scripture. So my question is, if God says that some of those people are going to be part of the kingdom, there's got to be a way that he makes their sins go away without them ever even asking. That's what it's saying. How is that possible? How is that possible? How will there be little aborted babies in heaven who never asked to have their sins taken away? They didn't believe, they didn't repent, they didn't do anything on their part to be in heaven.
Well, it's because the Bible says that it applies to the whole human race, who through no fault of their own were faithful to the light they had been, whatever that light may have been. And now we're going to get a quote from Desire of Ages here. It's on page 638, paragraph 2. It says, their works are evidence that the Holy Spirit has touched their hearts, and they are recognized as the children of God.
Yeah.
But they still had Adam's nature. They still had the condemnation of death that would be attributed to them because they were born they're born from Adam. So how did God solve the sin problem? What did God do so he could take these people with him to heaven? Well, what he did was he became part of us. In the incarnation, Jesus took on our DNA. He took on the fallen human nature, which was even worse than the nature that Adam had, because it was subject to all those years of worse and worse and worse physical things. We studied about, we've been talking about creation. We have that wonderful description of the dogs that have their big A, little B's, big A, you know, big B, little B. We watched that video. Genetic material has been getting less and less information as the years have gone by, not more and more. So there's less genetic information or power in a person today than there was in Jesus' day, and so we have more disabilities, we have more things to fight. Jesus came after 2,000 years, oh no, 4,000 years for him, 4,000 years for him, after 4,000 years after Adam had already fallen. And he took our human nature and he took it to the cross. When he took it to the cross, it was crucified, and yet he was dead, he was buried, and he rose again, and he rose to newness of life. And so it's that taking our penalty to the cross that gives everybody, there's nobody for whom he didn't do this. And it's already done, it's an accomplished fact. So you can't find a person on the planet who's ever lived or whoever will live for whom he has not already done this. Now that should make you feel different about your salvation, because now it's not, for me, I'm a toddler and I'm trying to hold on to a hand that I can't do it. Oh, maybe that's not the best illustration. I love the fact that my Heavenly Father holds onto my hand.
Right.
And that what he did for me, he did for me. Let's go ahead and look and see what else I was thinking of when we put this together. We already talked about the planning phase, where way back when Jesus was crucified before the foundation of the earth, of the world, God had in his mind that his creation that he was going to make, that one day his son would become part of that creation and redeem it to himself. I may not say all the words perfect that I'm trying to say, but I do know that if you think about that being in foundation in times past, in order for God to have anybody he could actually have fellowship with, I didn't like to play with dolls. I'll just put it out there. They were there. I learned to change the diapers, and I put the pins on, and it was like, okay, mission accomplished. Okay, you put the clothes on, you take the clothes off, and now we're done. The doll never talked to me. The doll never, gave me a hug back. The doll never, they finally got ones that you can tip their head back and forth, and this is,
their eyes would open and shut. Oh, we thought that was a big deal. Then they had Chatty Cathy, and you could pull the string, and she would talk. But the point is that in order to have fellowship with the doll, I needed a baby. I needed a real baby. You know, I needed somebody that had that when they didn't like their green peas, they'd spit them out. You know, that had a will, that had a choice or had something going on besides some doll. So God didn't make us like that. He made us with a power to choose. So when it came time to say I love you, He wasn't pulling a string that just said, I love you. We weren't robots. We were real. And he wanted to walk with us in the garden with Adam and Eve in the cool of the garden. He wanted them to say, oh, I saw this caterpillar and now it's turned into a butterfly. It's so wonderful, God. So what did he do? He made us as much like himself as he could. In his image we were made. He did everything for us. And now in this time of experimental, now what he's done for us is done. And then he says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. He's saying, come to me. You know, you're living worried about you're going to die. I want you to just come to me. And he's already done this thing for us. And now it's up to us to say, what do we say next?